In the second week of March 2019, my fiance and I took a trip to LA on vacation. While I was there, I managed to get myself onto my favorite podcast. And a little bit too close to closing time at most of the stores, we managed to take part of the family up to Little Tokyo, an area of town full of Japanese stores and restaurants, such as the famous bookstore Kinokuniya, from which I've purchased many art books at their stalls at Otakon over the years, as well as fashion outlets like Pop Killer, where I got this fucking awesome Totozilla t-shirt, and a really terrible karaoke. By the time we left, there were rats all over the area, but it was otherwise a pretty nice place. Anyways, we had less than half an hour inside of Kinokuniya, and were desperately searching for a Shintaro Kago art book, not being able to read his name in Japanese. But my fiance Mei was also scoping out for any Precure art books. I had purchased the Heartcatch Precure art book at Kinokuniya a few years back, being as I'm a huge fan of the character designer. Mei, who's recently been deep diving the entire Precure franchise, has just recently completed the first two seasons, and was excited to find an art book centered around that series. So we picked that up on the way through our little Tokyo adventure. Once we got home and she started flipping through the art book, she was excited to find out about other shows that this character designer had worked on before Precure at Toei Animation, and thus became curious about a show called The Crayon Kingdom of Dreams. Immediately, I was excited to see my fiancé exhibiting the same kind of otaku behavior that I have always been prone to, as somebody who has long been curious about watching Ojamajo Doremi because it has the same character designer as Heartcatch Precure and appears in the art book that I have. But when I saw this show, a late 90s sort of magical girl looking show that I'd never heard of, I immediately started regaling her with the story of how I came upon a show called Goldfish Morning, which I've only seen a couple episodes of, but I really enjoyed what I'd seen. The reason that I knew about Goldfish Warning is that a lot of the core staff of that show went to work on Sailor Moon almost immediately afterwards, and a huge chunk of the people who worked on Sailor Moon would then go on to make Revolutionary Girl Utena. Now, I'm very fond of finding the connections between different artists who've worked on the same shows multiple times, because a lot of the time when I look at a variety of shows that I've enjoyed, they tend to share a lot of the same staff members. I've explored this kind of stuff heavily in videos like Akiyuki Shinbo in the 90s and 2000s, Tracing the Lineage of Cowboy Bebop, and way back on my friend Ghost Lightning's blog, helping him to create the Revolutionary Girl Utena Diaspora. Ghost Lightning was very fascinated by finding moments in anime which paid direct visual homage to moments from other anime, only to turn out to share a lot of the same core staff. And he had realized a connection between various Ikuhara works because of the fact that there was imagery from Diebuster that reflected imagery from Revolutionary Girl Utena, which he had just watched, and then came to realize that Ikuhara had indeed storyboarded episode 2 of Diebuster. And so I immediately set to scouting through everyone who had worked on Utena's Anime News Network encyclopedia entry, and I just categorized everything into this gigantic chart where anytime two people related to this show had appeared on the same show together, I made note of it, so that you could see any place where any of this creative talent had overlapped and what that had generated when those two personalities were on the same project together. Now, the two big names that were at the heart of this chart were Junichi Sato and Kunihiko Ikuhara. Junichi Sato was the director on Goldfish Warning. I believe Ikuhara was an episode director. Going into Sailor Moon, Ikuhara stepped up and did even more episode direction, eventually becoming the head director of the series in its later seasons. However, Ikuhara eventually left the project with a bunch of staff members from it to go form Beipapas in order to make a much more experimental show that would allow them to really go deep with the more adult themes that they were trying to explore with Sailor Moon, and thus they made Revolutionary Girl Utena. Now, at the time, I had made the connection that Junichi Sato would come back in 2004 and create Princess Tutu, which is often compared to Revolutionary Girl Utena in how both of them kind of subvert elements of the Maho Shoujo genre and use its iconography to tell a darker, more compelling adult story than what would be typical of it, with a lot more attention to visual presentation and a sort of air of class about them. Princess Tutu and Revolutionary Girl Utena both have separate cult followings, but there is a lot of overlap. You see it in the artist alley. Now, aside from these shows, Junichi Sato is a deeply fascinating director who I've been following for a long time, regardless of his involvement with anything related to Revolutionary Girl Utena, and he didn't involve himself in that particular show at all. In many ways, Junichi Sato is like the godfather of the iyashike genre. He directed every season of Aria, he's the guy who made Tamayura, he did Amanchu a couple years ago, Umi Monogatari. Both successful and obscure iyashike shows, he's done a ton of it. He's also done a ton of kids shows, especially magical girl shows. Besides Goldfish Warning, Sailor Moon, he did Hojamajo Doremi, which itself also has something of a cult following online, and is starting to get talked about more and more in the same kind of circles that celebrate Princess Tutu and Revolutionary Girl Utena, even though it is seen as more of a legitimate children's show. He also directed Fushigi Boshi no Futako Hime, which is the most adorable fucking thing that was ever created. The most just over-the-top, cutesy, magical girl show that I think I've ever seen. But he's also done, like, action shows. He directed M3. He's been all over the place. I mean, the guy is an industry veteran, so it's not too much of a surprise that I haven't investigated every single show he's ever made, especially when it's not as though all of them are necessarily my favorites. I do like a lot of his catalog, but for instance, I wasn't super into Kaleidostar, and even that could be said to have its own cult following. I remember in the early 2000s when anime magazines were always singing that show's praises. Everybody kept playing up the angle that it was a Studio Gonzo show and that they were putting just as much effort into the acrobatic sequences as they would into an action scene in one of their other shows. Yeah, I don't think they were necessarily that impressive or trying to be that action-packed. It was a hard sell, and I don't think it really worked. But nonetheless, the show is beloved by a certain audience, and it's just one more reason that Junichi Sato has a legacy. But strangely enough, the one thing by him that I had never even heard of or known that he worked on was, sure enough, the Crayon Kingdom of Dreams. This one came out in the late 90s. Features a gorgeous color palette, explosively vibrant hand-drawn backgrounds, but with these very cutesy, simplistic character designs that almost don't work on the backgrounds except that they are so expressively animated. And Junichi Sato just has this way of going all in on the emotions of every scene that he shows, and I think that that is the core of his directing style that permeates all the different styles he works in. Whatever the tone of a scene is, he's gonna go all in on that tone. Crayon Kingdom of Dreams feels like a kid's show at times. It's very wacky and upbeat and cutesy and funny, but its main character is kind of a brat, and the central conceit of the show is that she has these 12 bad behaviors that she needs to correct in order to bring her parents back because they get turned to fucking stone in the first episode. And this scene is played in a way that is dramatic enough that you understand that something really terrible has happened, but while maintaining enough of a lighthearted nature that it could still be a kid's show and not be too scary. Now, you may know that Hojamajo Doremi has a reputation for the fact that it tackles somewhat more adult or more serious issues than what most kids shows of its nature will be willing to touch. And while Crayon Kingdom isn't as blatant in its approach, I really think that it nails what a fantastic YouTube video game critic named B-Mask has dubbed the purple feeling. He talked about this feeling that you can get from a lot of older children's cartoons, where strikingly potent messages or really striking imagery can create this sense of sort of fear in your mind as a child that you don't necessarily understand. This sense of witnessing something bigger than yourself. And in the most potent kids shows, they can manage to not scare you away from watching the show, but still give you these feelings that you didn't know you were going to experience as a human being. When you're watching this cute little show about a pink-haired girl in a magical kingdom, and then the prince shows up and she's blushing, thinking about how she's going to try to confess to this beautiful prince who looks just like her parents, who she loves so much, and then he turns them to stone before her very eyes on her birthday. And you have this sinking feeling that things don't generally go this girl's way in this show. That she is, you know, going to be punished for being a brat and is really going to have to learn and grow as a person in order to succeed in this world where there are dire consequences for, you know, continuing to be the way that she is. You start to think, wow, that's kind of serious. Even though, on a moment-to-moment level, the show is still being pretty lighthearted and fun. And so, of course, after we watched a couple of episodes of this, my fiancé says to me, well, this show is 70 episodes long, and only 48 of them have actually been subtitled. Hopefully, if you talk about this in a video, more people will want to watch it, and maybe somebody will come and subtitle the rest of it. But in the meantime, what if we go just watch Ojamajo Dorami? It's been on both of our plan to watch lists for a long time. It's also directed by Junichi Sato. It's got the other character designer who I love, and everybody on Twitter talks about it as soon as they watch it. Zen Huxtable's in the middle of going off about how much he loves the character designs. Let's watch Ojamajo Dorami. And I'm like, great, excellent. Ojamajo Dorami is absolutely adorable. It's a ton of fun to watch. It's very similar to the other show, and I would dare say that if you like one, you might like the other, even though I think Ojamajo Dorami is a bit more grounded since it takes place in reality and not in a fantasy world. But it definitely shares that aspect of leaning in really hard to the emotions of each scene, to really letting a sad moment be sad and a hyperactive moment be incredibly hyperactive in a way that reminds me of Kodocha. And right away I was struck by the opening theme, which I absolutely loved. Comes through like an epic power ballad, and I'm absolutely looking forward to hearing it at the start of every episode, memorizing all of the lyrics, and eventually performing it at karaoke somewhere amidst other anime fans. Because one of the great things about being an otaku is that it's not about how late you join the bandwagon, it's about eventually getting there and sharing something with other people like you that only you've taken the time to understand.